I know you're gonna dig this.
I'm Trent Darby, host of the Dayton Scene Radio Show, bringing you a new episode of the Funk Music Hall of Fame and Exhibition Center's award-winning show, Funk Chronicles, recorded live here at DATV Studios in Dayton, Ohio. And now zooming in all the way from the country of Switzerland, he's Mario Mantese, original member and bass guitarist with the funk group Heatwave. Welcome and thank you so much for agreeing to come on our show, Mario.
Thank you. You're welcome.
All right. Hey, Mario, I have to ask you because you play one of my favorite instruments that I always wanted to play, and that's the bass guitar. Tell us how it all began for you picking up that instrument.
Well, I was 12 years old, and the guy told me, come and sing a song for us with the band. I want to sing, and they said, we need a bass player. I say, okay. Next day, I went to the shop, plugged in, bang! I said, oh, that's it. That's what I want to do, bass. So, with 14, for the age of 14, I was always on stage. I just love bass. That's my thing.
Now, Mario. Bass, yeah, I was.
Bass is my life.
Exactly. Let me ask you, was there any influences on that particular instrument growing up? Were there any bass players that you said, yeah, I really like their sound?
We just came only later on, of course, Marcus Miller, Stanley Clark, you know, there were so many, many huge mountains of bass players. And then I said, wow, these guys are too much. So they made me feel good. So I said, I have to get near to them, I will never be like them, but I have to get near to them. So that was my inspiration. Also, now I saw Miles Davis with the musician he had. I said, what? When I saw them, I said, wow, incredible sounds. And so I saw, you know, I felt really, really close to the black music, Afro-American music, like James Brown. But in our age, we were playing blues and rock and roll. But I felt very close to the music. You know, I live in a small city, and here there was not so much music. There were a lot of musicians, but you were not so close to the big things. But there was one thing which turned me on. When I was 13, I saw the television, The Beatles. The Beatles, and they played a song, I want to hold your hand. And I said, but this guy's made it. I want to have that tune. I want to be like that. And I never left that. So I said, one day I will be there too. I made it.
Oh, well, Mario, I have to ask you, I mean, because during the 70s, you knew all about the many groups that came out of Dayton, Ohio, the Ohio Players, Slave, Heatwave, Zapp and Roger. But I have to ask you, how did you become a full-time member of the group Heatwave?
Well, that was quite a strange situation because I played in the blues band, and a friend of mine said, you should come see. Near us there's an Afro-American group, all black people, and they are looking for a bass player. So I said, okay. So So I go with him, join the club, and I sat there and listened to the group he gave. And it was quite, the most of the songs they played, I didn't know. So at 1 o'clock at night, Johnny came and dressed the girl, just waiting. This was my main man. I just want to show you for the pictures so you understand who I'm talking about.
Oh, that brings back some memories. Look at those pictures.
That's Jesse, see? Jesse Whitten, that was my man, you know? He said, come to with us, you know? John said, okay, come to us, you're going to have a good time. So I said, okay. I went back home, I was married, and my wife, I said to my wife, 3 o'clock at night, this is our chance to go. With Heatwave, she said, oh, that's your life, go, just go, go, that's your thing. I left. I was gone for 8 years, and I never came back. And Heatwave, it was a lot of work, because just we shared the room, we took hours and hours and hours to explain the songs, the feeling, and then I worked very, very hard. Slowly I got into that, and I never regretted to be with Heatwave.
Mario Mantese of Heatwave is my guest here on the Funk Chronicles. Now, let's get right to the crust of the matter, and that was your music, the group as a whole. Let's go back to 1977 for a moment, Mario. As the band released the album Too Hot to Handle, kind of delve into the making of that album for you guys.
Well, I was very close to Rod Temperton. We were friends until he's dead. And I remember the day when he came and said, I have two songs. And they were instrumentals. And then he said, I have one more, and it was and a half separate. And then we found someone who said, okay. And then we went there and stood for 3 months. And that was just, for us, it was new. But we were there hours and hours, days and days, every day, working on that. And I just, we had to sound as wow, wow, wow. And then the boss of the record company said, this one will be hit, this one will be hit, and this one will be hit. 3 songs, he said, will be hit, Boogie, Always and Forever, and One More. Yeah. And I was just thrilled. We all were really open. We thought that could be it, and it was that. Huh? And you know, one of my favorite songs is Star of the Story. This song should win on 2 or 3. We were very tired, and 3 o'clock, 3 o'clock late, Johnny said, let's give it a shot. You know? And then I changed the strings of my bass, and then we had some sort of it's magic. I love that song. I could listen to 1,000 times and I still enjoy that song. The Star of the Sun is just magic. One guy from New York, DJ, said, you know, I played that song at that 3 o'clock at night, and it's magic. It's magic. I love Star of the Sun.
Well, obviously, Mario, the first single off that particular album was the Boogie Nights in 1977. It charted number 5 on the R&B chart, and it did just as well on the Hot 100 chart. Did you really think that song was not only going to be strong nationally, but internationally as well? What was your thoughts on how popular that song became so quickly?
I never think like that. You know, we were working every day. We were playing every day, hours and hours and hours. And we just started, we felt that something's there. Then it was in the charts in England, and all of a sudden in the States. And I thought, wow, wow, now this one is really taking off and hot. It's very fast.
Yes. You know, I was thinking, obviously, you, the likes of Rod, Bilbo, all from different parts of the world. But we did, of course, have a couple of members from Dayton, Ohio, the Wilder brothers, Johnny and Keith. Talk what your relationship was like with those brothers being a part of the success of Heatwave.
Well, I was very close to Keith. We were very close. Johnny also, but he had a bit a little different outer career of Wild. Johnny, Keith and me were the Wild guys. We went out in the night time to look for life and night matter. And better, I'm very close to Eric Jones. I liked him very much when he left. It got strange for me. And Keith and Rod, I had a very, very deep relationship to Rod all my life. And he also is working there. No, I lived with him in the flat, with Rod, in Germany. And on the road, we shared the room all the time. I remember he said once to me in the 74, 3, no, as soon as I get the hit, I will leave the Heatwave. I'm not great at the stage. And then he said to me, we watched a movie with Vince Price, and he said, this guy with Price, I would like to do what something with him. Later on, he did on Thriller. And he was just my inspiration. My inspiration, he was day and night. You know? Day and night, day and night, day and night. And I said, I never thought I would be someone like him. You know? He's not only a genius, he was just a person which is from other worlds. You know? He's just a genius, really a wonderful person. We had a good relationship. So, slowly, and you can never know. You know? So all of a sudden, you are there, and I remember we played in a club in Switzerland. And there came a man from the Atlanta, Georgia. He came to the club and said, guys, I want you to come to Atlanta, Georgia for a concert. And he said, we cannot go, we are tied up to the club. He said, I think all we do, also the manager of the club, and we went to Atlanta, Georgia. In England, we played for 5,000 people, and there all of a sudden, there were 50,000 people. That was just a step in the other dimension. Then we felt something is there which will change our lives, and it did. Then we saw that something is really happening, and we enjoyed just music. I'm not one who's looking for success. I'm looking for the music. I love music, and it's my passion. So I'm not so keen to be sad.
Yes. You know, Mario, oftentimes groups that first start out, they have that propensity for changing the group's name. But I have to ask you, how did you guys come up with the group name Heatwave?
Well, that was a long time before. It was before I left, even though I said, there was a keyboard player, Candy. He once in the room, he saw in the winter time that there was a heatwave on the radio. They said we could be called Heatwave. And that was it. That was before me. And I met the guy, but Heatwave was before. And then this guy here, Jesse, he was from Chicago. So he said we was called Chicago Heatwave for a while. And then we changed again. And Jesse, it was a clown, a real musician, and just a genuine guy. I loved him very much. Heatwave is something which is very old, the name, you know? So, I met the guy, he's a keyboard player in that day. And he said, you know, I saw that heat get out there, I said, this Heatwave could be our name. We took it.
You know, I was thinking, you know, during the decade of the 70s, for example, You obviously had funk with James Brown. You had Rick James come on the scene, and as I alluded to, some of the local bands, but I wanted to zoom in on a particular genre at that particular time, and that was disco. So you had the likes of the Bee Gees, you had Donna Summer. Now, did you guys have any difficulty trying to find your own brand or your style that you guys wanted to present to the music audience?
Never, never. We just did our thing. You know? We never let right and left. We just did our thing, our own thing. You know? That's thing. See, we were on. We played many songs of War, you know, of Isley Brothers, OJs, and all those guys. Later on, we were on the road with them. I saw them with the professional people, and I liked them. But then I saw that we have our own song, you know? So our sound is just different. And I don't know who said that once. I think it's in the radio interview, the person said, you know, Heatwave was the first crossover band which everyone listened to. Black and white, all listened to the same music. And that was also a click for us, you know. It was a band of music which everyone would listen to. That's a win-win thing, you know. That was really good, you know.
Speaking with Mario Mantese, bass guitarist for the funk group Heatwave, joining us on the Funk Chronicles. Now, Mario, I'd be remiss if I didn't bring up the song that still radiates not only in radio, but wedding receptions, among others. Got to talk about Always and Forever, because that was a follow-up single to Boogie Nights back in 1977. I know you are sure how impactful that song still is to this day, you know, 45 years later. Talk about the making of Always and Forever, that beautiful ballad.
Yeah, well, for us, when I started to play that, I knew that would be a hit, I'm sure, because the atmosphere is so good, you know, it touches the heart. And I felt when you started to play it, to learn the song, slowly, I felt this one is something different, you know, and it's there, and also Forever is always on Forever, you know. It's a classic one, it will remain. It's really a very, very strong song. And, you know, Rod came and he played some, on the keyboard, some lines, and he said, you know, this song, we called Always and Forever, and we started to look at it, and slowly, got into it, and when it was finished, said, this one is a big one. I was sure. Huh? Because this was really a very, very special take we had. Really, very good. Eric Jones was just a brilliant guitar player. You know? He was really, really, very nice and good. And so we had the right people, the right time, the right place to play the songs. You know? That's. Later on, he difficult it on, but that was the magic this time. That was a big magic. Huh? It's magic, the song, you know. I travel a lot. I was in Japan a few years ago. In the morning, I eat breakfast, I listen to the radio, Always and Forever. I went to India. In the morning, I had Always and Forever. Always and Forever is all over the world. And I would say, wow, of all these years, still playing. Huh? That's a good feeling.
You know, we're going to talk about your follow-up album the following year, Central Heating, here shortly. But I have to ask you this. I know that once Boogie Nights and Always Forever became big, not long after that, I'm pretty sure at some point you guys hit the road. Do you have some stories you could share about maybe the first time going out on tour, or maybe some of the groups and artists that you either opened for or you closed with?
Well, you know, 8 years, we were only on the road. I never had an apartment. We were always on the road. We played every day. And in Germany, six hours a night. You know? We were all to live in the fact that we were rehearsing, and the another way we were playing. Every time we were just music. And I remember when the first tour we were with Rufus Shaka Khan. They were with us, and of course we were new. And everyone was out to see us, and say, everyone thought that Tony was the composer, and they said, what? This guy, Rod Temperton, has composed that. That is not possible. But he, one guy who can make this in Laquitz, he said, you know, so we leave things about that. And he said, you know, Rod Temperton has done something black in him, you know, some soul black heart, which enables him to do such things. You know? That was the, and there were so many concerts. But of course, Madison Square Garden was the top. There was, you know, 21,000 people, and we had such a success. And you know, for Johnny and Keith and them, if you can make it there, you can make it everywhere. That's the one, you know. So we were really very, very successful. Yeah? I like it a lot. I like to be stage. That was my life. All my life, I was always on stage, and I'm music, and my life is just that. I was rehearsing every day, always to get better. Get the funk. And see, I spoke to a friend the other day. I said, you know, through Jesse also written, it's not only to learn patent, but I had to learn the feeling of the Afro-American people. It's not only soul, it's not only music, it's something, soul food, you know. I get the food, I get the voices, you know. I mean, Donny Hathaway, James Brown, Isaac Hayes, all these guys have voices which are just so big and strong, you know, as James Brown. They are just really great. And I met Steve Wonder in London. We were a few days, 4 hours together. Just such an enormous person, such good people, you know. And he was a big fan of Boogie Nights, you know. And so, guys, this one is a good one. I met some really nice people. And you see, I was very interested in, I read the books of Malcolm Lewis. No? I all this, you know, I have such a deep feeling for Rosa Parks, for Malcolm Lewis, Martin Luther King, and also Sharpton. They're all people with voices, with different researches, but they are there. And I feel them with heart in my heart. Soul is not only singing, it's a way of life. That's for me very important, not only to sing, to see how these people live. I was in ghettos in LA, and all over. I visited the ghettos, and I was shocked. You know? I was shocked how people can have to live in that way. In Harlem, in those days, you know? And I said, something is wrong. Everything is wrong there, and I think I should talk also for the people there, because I feel that soul is much more than only sin, you know. Sorry to mention that, but it's important for me to mention that. There are really people with good verses, not only singers, but also the other guys. Huh? So I think soul has deep roots. I felt, you know, I can never be like that, but I could do the best to be close to that, because I love these people very much in my heart. You know? It's just part of my life. I lived 8 years with Afro-American people. My friends were all Afro-American people, and I felt I should be able to feel them better than before, and I did. That's also my music.
Well, Mario, I have to ask you this, because we've had several episodes of the Funk Chronicles where A number of our guest musicians have talked about some experiences about going on the road. For example, drummer Michael Beard from the Bar K's was talking about performing and doing very well, and in lieu of mentioning the group that was coming on after them. Have you ever experienced where you guys were doing a jam session and the band that's coming on after you, you know, told you to cut it, cut it short and get off stage? Have that ever happened to you?
I'm not in that way, but we had big bands, which were at the top of the bill, and they asked us, why would we change? We should play before and we play after, because we had so much energy, you know, but I don't want to mention names, because it was kind of, we play after, but we, of course, we didn't do that. But you see, I think it's also a family, you know? The musicians are a family. I think we should also restrict for each other. It was always important to have respect for the musician. I'm not the best player, but not the worst. So I think we should just look. Now, I spoke with so many musicians on the road, so good musicians, and also, but we are a family. So why should we, be like bad with each other? I don't like that. I'm not like that. I just love musicians and love the world. I love people, that's for me, I think which I've already, as a child, I love people. I don't have that competition thing in me. I think I made my job well. And I think we deserved what we had, because we worked so hard for that. So then, after that, the music changed and there were other guys which come in. We don't have that. I cannot recall that, because I don't see that with me. We had, like I told you, some things which were quite strange. We were in New Orleans, and to get the food, the first time I showed you the picture. It's not there. See?
Yes.
A whole wall of them.
Yes, I remember that. Yes.
We got the first 6-1, and then there was all the guy, very famous bass player, and he said, you're nothing. But in the end of the day, he had a little single, and we had 6. So I said, see, your arrogance is good, but we made it, So don't be too loud. Some of the strange things, but like that's the way life is, So I just go ahead. I just still talk with the people. I like them all. But sometimes if you get loud, then you have to shudder again. So I'd rather be modest.
Now let's pick it back, because you had great success with the debut album in 1977, Too Hot to Handle. Then the following year, you did just as well with Central Heating. So let's talk about that debut single off that particular album, The Groove Line, which charted number 3 on the R&B chart, number 7 on the Hot 100 chart. What do you love about that particular song?
Well, I tell you, there was something there. When I played Roland, I had an idea to use a phaser. Because the sound is very special in Roland. It's boom, 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 boom. And this was a phaser. And John said, wow, that sounds really good. So I said, let's do that. So the sound is good. And we had to make a lot of routines, the choreography and all that. We had to really work hard on that, because the steps have to really be tight. If one does not be with us, then it's difficult. So we have to learn a lot. And like groove line, it's a good groove line. The groove line is a groove line. It's really a group in line. I like that. I still like it. I listen to it and think, wow, all the sales back and still, I like our music. I like all the songs because we were so hard on all the songs. I like them all. So, for me, it's just Caesar of his music. My heart. And Johnny, he was like an engine, you know. He wanted really to have success, and we went on and on.
You know, the one thing, Mario, I remember I was in college the first time I not only promoted you guys' album, Central Heating, amongst a number of my former teammates and my classmates down in Daytona Beach, Florida. And I remember one night I actually caught, before videos were popular, and I'm sure you probably saw it because you guys were doing Groove Line, and I saw you being the tallest member in the band, playing the bass and doing some steps along the way. Talk a little bit about, you know, mastering, not only playing the bass, but moving to the same steps as your other band members.
Well, it's hard work. It's not like that. I had to really get into it, but once you feel it, then you really, but still then, you know? So you have to sing, you have to dance, and you have to play. But that, I think, the choreography is still left off. And then the Groove Line, once you get it, then you got it. And just first you get the song, then you get the feeling, and then you say, okay, now check it out. And all of a sudden you feel, okay, now that's it. And then it goes to the body works on itself. You don't have to do it anymore. It just works for you. You have to let it go, you know, so to do it. If you think you lost, you cannot think of playing and singing. It's just you are that and then let it go and it goes on. So that's the way to go. Let it go.
You know, on that particular pardon me there, Mario. I'd be remiss if I didn't mention there were some connections to that particular album personally for me. And my fiance, who I met down in Florida, loves the song Mind-Blowing Decisions. Talk about how that song came about.
Well, that's a song of Roy Carter. He came later on and he was a very, very talented musician. And also that, I was surprised the journey. It's not really hitting. It's a different song. And still, it's fitted well in. At the beginning, after what is that? What exactly is that? And then once you get in, the feeling, it's a wonderful song, a wonderful song. Rock Hart is a very, very talented man. I like it. It's really a mind-blowing decision. It goes to mind. That's called mind-blowing decision.
Now my colleague David Webb, president and CEO of the Dayton Funk Center and co-host of the Dayton Scene, we play your music all the time on the show, and I think I could speak for him that one of our personal favorites is Send Out for Sunshine. So just tell us how that came about, because the arrangements were beautiful. We could hear you playing the bass. The rhythm guitar was just, I mean, it was impeccable. The vocals, that was some of the best background lead vocals of any of the songs, and all of them were great. But tell us about Send Out for Sunshine.
Well, it was quite funny because the Rod came and said, I have something to make a check. So he came and he said, we played the fourth, the first five bars. just to begin, I thought, oh, this is funky, funky, funky. And then I gave it a little part. I never thought this song, just a little bit at the time. And every day, then, how with the song be? And then you could do bass line, and all of a sudden, it was, I liked it. It's really funky. It's a really funky song. I like it very much. It's good. But I like also, you know, I like 38. And you know, the first song, I forget the name of the first song. And you see, Rod was there. You know, he was really special. On 38, you know, he had some glasses broken, and he had, for the song.
So tell us a little bit about, and of course, I wouldn't want to complete this interview without mentioning the late Rod Temperton, who passed away October 2016, who did the majority of the writing, composing. He was a keyboardist before stepping aside and Calvin Duke coming in. But talk about, you know, I mean, I know you guys were a group, but talk about what Rod Temperton meant to you, Mario Mantese.
Well, Rod Temperton is one of my best friends I ever had. We were really close. He called me every month, we called each other, I went to see him in LA. And he also, every year he rented a yacht on a big boat with him. And we were alone with friends of him. And it's just a really, really, really close relation. We called each other often. And he, little bit about Mike Jackson and Chris Jones, he spoke a lot about them, and he was a really special person. I miss him a lot. I think about him all the time. You know? It's like a family member left me. But I also have to mention one thing. His wife, Kathy, you know? Nobody talks about that, but his wife, Kathy, I was there when he met her, and she is so important in his life. They loved each other so much, and she held him all these years up the way she did. I think she's a wonderful person. I think I have to mention her, you know? And you see also our son in England, Dylan, he's also a bass player. He has my bass, and he plays the bass. I have relation to the people in a different way, but Rod, he was a wonderful, wonderful, wonderful person. I miss him very, very much, really. It was like a brother who lies, you know, for me. And I think about him very often, very often. I don't know how I, but I feel him very close to him. I was happy that Quincy Jones found a good friend there. We were like Quincy very much. It's about, you found someone important for him. That was good, very good. They were really good friends. That's nice. But Rod was a genius. You know? I remember him, you know, I was with him living in a flat. And I see him just laying there on the bed. Right then. Then you were booked to the organ. Right, and the lyrics, and then the great dad. And he never slept. He said very little, 3 or 4 hours a night. If I was active, all night is full of music. And he was just very, very special. I'm very proud. Happy to have met a person like him. He's a very outstanding person, very outstanding person. Yeah. So, it's a great loss for us all that he had to leave so early, but his music required him. We were on a boat trip in Mediterranean, and he said, listen, I have some 6 songs. Listen to them. And with 6 songs, for George Benson, he could choose one of them. Choose one George Benson. And he said, and they were just all, they were all just incredible songs, incredible songs. I think, I'm sure they're still the haunted songs there, which never even left the studio. It was really, really creative, really creative. But I used to really honor him, and we had such a good time. We went for the, no? I was with Jesus before you came. So we made an advert in an English newspaper and said we look for a keyboard player. Then we had answer and he left Grosters in Germany. Well, Tommy Harris, the drummer which we had before, Johnny and I went to his house. There was this tiny skinny guy with a cigarette in his hand, and he said, okay, I'm Rod Temperton. Okay. Johnny said then, can you play this song? I said, yes. And then, can you play some rhythmic? And after 5 minutes, he said, this guy, we need that guy. We were just, you know, breathing. And 1 week later, he came to us. He left the group, he was in Cambridge. So, see, he had then with us the opportunity to do the music which he was able to do. You know? It was really, we were his tools for him, you know? To really compose the songs. He was really, really good. You know? But, thank you. Hope you are well wherever you are. Thank you.
And all music fans, you know, thank him too, Rod Temperton, not only for Heatwave, but he was very instrumental for the likes of George Benson with Gimme the Night, also Light Up the Night for the Brothers Johnson, a couple of big tunes for Michael Jackson, the title cut Off the Wall and Rock With You, and of course Rod is going to be sorely missed. I want to shift gears here, Mario Mantese, a bassist of the R&B group Heatwave is our guest today on the Funk Chronicles. Now, if a young musician approaches you and they want to pursue a career in music, talk a little bit about the business aspect of things that they should know.
Well, you see, the business is later. First, you have to have a good group. Don't think about business, think about music, you know. And I sometimes they come and better, I see they. They don't have that bite. They play the music, but they don't have that, the really that push, that one. The willpower to really go. If you don't have that, forget it. You know? If you don't believe in what you are doing and you are not really there, you need the passion. And unless the passion is there, you will not go nowhere. You know? I have this passion. I started with it, and then the door opened me and I took it right away. And I never had doubts, I just went. And I went with Heatwave to Germany. And I think my passion and honesty is very important. Business is later on. You know? You don't want to talk business about a group which is learning to play music. You know? So once the business is there, then it's different. And you know, money. It's good, it's important, but I never played for money, I played for music. Money is then something which came with it, and I spent so much, and I spent everything. I did not save anything. But now I will do everything to the maximum. I enjoyed the life so much. I said, what should I save money now? Let's do it. Later on, I could do it again, and I did. You know? I've written 20 books now. 20 books are published for me in 6 languages. I teach philosophy in many countries of the world. I'm again successful. I have a very good life. And I don't worry about money. Money is with me all the time. So I write every day, 7 days a week, I'm writing books every day. Every day, Sunday, Monday, Tuesday, every day, I write and write and write. I'm always open. Mm-hmm. Open. I feel the creativity is there. Music and that also, so we should be open enough to push the real amount. If you don't want it, you will never go there. If you are a musician, a passion, it may happen. But you see, there are millions of good musicians there. But if the situation is not there, because you cannot go alone, you need a band. You need good songs. So if it happens, it happens, but usually it's very difficult to find the right people. That's I was a good musician, but in the end, it's difficult. I remember when we played the Washington D.C. in the concert, 80,000 people. And there was this man which came up from America, and he came and said, "Can I go to my house for a tea?" I said, "Okay." And then he said, "I'm looking for a band. I'm working with young guys in the band, and I come to the ghetto and do the celebrate hours." I went there. They were so happy to see the very place where he was coming down to the cellar. They were young guys, really, they were really good musicians, and 6 and 7 years old, good musicians. But he said, what can you do for me, for them? I said, what can I do for them? I cannot do nothing for them. I cannot make business for them. They really have to check out a manager, someone which helps them to go. You know? But there are thousands and thousands of good musicians, but their life, the day was made that I came to see them. You know? The best player of Heatwave which comes to see them. They play with Boogie. They play our songs, but they were good. And it's not, you cannot do that much as you think. Like you can help them to have passion for the music. Passion is the most important. If you don't have passion, forget it. Now, if you think of money when you make music, forget it. You will never go there. You have to be really, you have a heart full of soul. Mm-hmm. The heart is full of soul, then you know what it means to really go. And see, these guys, the Wilders and Chuck and Keith and Jesse, they come out of the ghetto. Mm-hmm. Their only chance was really to succeed. And they did, because they had the push to go. To become successful, if you don't have that, then they can do that. But I think I really, this guy also, this Jesse, I will never ever forget him. Never in my life I will forget him. He's just such a brilliant musician and such a good man. Thank you, Jesse. Thank you for everything you did for me. he helped to become a soulman. Really helped me. He teach me and showed me the situation which was there. And I think just was fantastic.
While we have one moment, I wanted to ask you because all the way from Switzerland, you are remembered here in Dayton, Ohio, because we had the advent of the Dayton Funk Center and exhibition, or the Dayton Music Hall of Fame and Exhibition Center, in the process of getting the building together. What are your thoughts, or I should say, what were your thoughts when you heard that this museum was going up in Dayton, Ohio?
I think this was why I said, okay. Because I get so many, I get every year 10, 20 people ask me for auditions for interviews. I never do. But this thing I said, this I do it definitely. But I think this is fantastic what they are doing there, fantastic. I give you my award. My Grammy Award and nomination is in the museum. So I said, I will give them my box set and here, give them to the museum. So I give it to you. I think this is a wonderful idea. It's the music which is there should not be lost, because it's a wonderful music. Now they have up their house, it's different. But still, this music there, it's precious, you know, it's heartful, it's full of life, full of soul, and we should never forget the soul music of soul, you know. If you see, I listen to Whitney Houston, I can listen to all this, that, if I listen, I saw a tears in my eyes. Or, she's just so soulful, you know. Who can do that, you know? And also the American, Rita, I had one on the phone, Rita spoke to her on the phone, and I said to her, you know, I admire you, you can let me tell you how I admire you, Rita. Wonderful person. So these people there gave me also the power to feel good, you know. Be on the good level, that was important. All these people raped me to that which I am today, soul. Punk soul. I think, you know, and I said so many musicians came and went for me there, because we worked so hard. For many of them, it was too much, you know, too much. And you know, to come to Germany, we rehearsed every day, 6 hours every day. And in the night, we had 6 hours in the night. And for many of them, they could not take it to watch. When they were soft, when they and me, we were always there. We haven't, to the end, we were there, and after the accident, we still have the contact. And I really, it was also a man which never gave up. I was one of those. At this accident, you know, sorry, my speech was not okay, but I'm here. I'm still here, I'm still doing my thing, and still carry on. And I go every day, step ahead, and never, nothing can stop me. Never. Always and forever, never stop.
Well, Mario, it's been indeed a pleasure to have an opportunity to talk to you, because I've been a big fan of not just the group, but yours, being a bass player of the group Heatwave. And again, I want to thank you so much for taking the time out to talk to us today. And hopefully we'll be talking to you again down the line.
Who knows? Thank you very much for inviting me. Thank you.
Thank you. This is Trent Darby, host of the Dayton Scene Radio Show. This has been another episode of the award-winning show, Funk Chronicles. Until the next time, let's keep it funky.
Thank you, and stay healthy, and you all think about it. In the heart is full of soul, everything will be okay. Thank you.
Thank you.